Okay, we're going to get started. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the annual Debris Management Coordination meeting. Yes, unfortunately, it is time to start thinking about these things again. Storm season is on its way, less than a month. And unfortunately, as I'm sure all of you have heard, they're predicting another busy one for us. This morning, I want to introduce a couple of people that are going to be assisting me with the presentation. First, Ms. Mariana Felspach. She's our operations manager, customer service operations manager. Over on my right here, we have John Archambo, who's our director of customer service. Paul Gonzalez, who's our field services manager. And Karen Cantor, who is with our environmental programs. She can assist us with pre-authorization of sites if we need that. All of these folks are veterans of the collection business and have responded to numerous storms. So those of you who have attended this meeting in the past, you'll see a lot of similarities with not a whole lot of changes in the presentation. But what we're going to talk about is our first and second priorities following a storm, a little bit about the interlocal agreements that we have with the various municipalities and districts, truck certifications, placards, the debris removal and debris monitoring contracts that we have in place, pre- and post-storm communications, planning and response, our 2022 pre-authorized sites that are set up, load tickets, load and debris site monitoring operations, a quick overview of the Thompson Consulting overview and electronic ticket system. By the way, we also have Corey Thomas on the line, joining us virtually from Thompson, should we need to have him address any questions. We're going to talk a little bit about gated communities. That's an item that always comes up every year. And again, the contact information for all of the people that I just mentioned. All of this is on our website. A lot of the documents that I'm going to be talking about are on our website, the collection ordinances, the contracts, which as of today, we have all of the contracts available from our collection contractors and Thompson, our monitoring contractor. Those are all available to be piggybacked by municipalities, should you decide to do that. And also, I think this presentation will be available on site should you want to review it later. So what's our first priority? I think it's pretty obvious. It's garbage. Following a storm, our number one priority is, other than getting out, assessing the damage to our facilities, assessing the various collection districts and damage in them, our number one priority is to get garbage service back on as close to a regular schedule as possible. And we'll use all the resources for the first 10 days or so to try to make that happen. Then we start getting into more storm recovery, separation of garbage at the curb, vegetation, and then, of course, the mixed storm debris, C&D, and other things. Those will all be tackled as we move into the heart of the response. Interlocal agreements are necessary for participation in the SWA debris sites. I believe that we have interlocal agreements signed with all 39 municipalities and a couple of the special districts, and those give you the ability to use our sites. They detail all of the information as far as financial responsibilities and everything else. So please review those. Using an SWA debris site is optional. There are a few municipalities that have their own. If you are one of those, we would like to know about it if you plan on operating your own debris site after a storm. Each city is responsible for collection within their own jurisdiction, the right-of-ways within their own jurisdiction. Again, all of this stuff is detailed in the agreement. Nothing really new here. And it also details the cost and reimbursement portion So at this point, I'm going to quickly hand it over to Mariana. She's going to go over a few of the details in terms of the truck certs, and then I'll come back and finish up, and we'll answer questions at the end.
Good morning, everyone. The SWA provides our municipal and governmental partners the opportunity to have their in-house hurricane debris collection vehicles certified prior to hurricane season. This is a great way to jumpstart your cleanup, and we do encourage you to take advantage of this opportunity if you're able to. Our contractor, Thompson Consulting Services, will be certifying collection vehicles from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. here at our Jog Landfill on July 12th and at our Lantana Transfer Station on July 13th. A few of our municipal partners have made plans with Thompson directly to have their trucks certified, so if you're interested in that, please contact them directly. Please remember, all collection vehicles must be certified every year. Previous certifications will not be accepted. Again, the certification from Thompson Consulting is required for all collection vehicles, and they need to have their certification barcodes present to enter any of our temporary debris management sites. All collection vehicles that are not certified with expired certification or without the barcode will not be allowed to enter our sites. If you are able to take advantage of our pre-certification, please do so, and that will help you. If you can't make it, you're going to have to wait until after the storm, until we're up and running to get your certifications. As many of you already know, we finished a competitive procurement process for both our debris removal and monitoring contracts. During the process, four qualified contractors were selected to manage eligible generated storm debris, and one qualified contractor was selected for monitoring services. The contract language still contains the provisions allowing the contracts to be accessed through cooperative purchasing. It can now be found under Article 33. It was previously 34. That's on page 11 of the contract and page 14 of the website PDF. Here are the four awarded contractors: Ashbridge, Crowder Gulf, Phillips and Jordan, and DRC Services. The contract term is for 3 years with a potential 3-year extension. And Thompson Consulting was again awarded, and the contract term is the same. As Patrick mentioned, you can find all of this at swa.org/hurricane. You want to click on the municipality and waste hauler button. Then you want to follow the link under awarded contracts. All right, back to you, Patrick.
Thanks. And those contracts are all 3 years with a 3-year extension option. So presumably we'll have those locked in for 6 years. So the old adage, communication is the key, is never more true than after a storm. Today is the first step in that process. Having all of you guys here and online virtually helps us get that process started. For all of you who have not provided us with contact information, please make sure that you do that so that we have a good list for the contacts for each of your cities and districts. As in years past, primarily faxes, emails, news releases, pre-storm, that's how we'll be getting out the information on the status of our facilities, when we'll be closing, these kinds of things. The EOC, we have a representative at the EOC during and after this, well, pre-storm, during the storm, and post-storm. We do have somebody there full-time. They'll be coordinating all of our information through the county EOC, where they use the web EOC system. I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with that. Post-storm, we also do a lot of conference calls with League of Cities and other organizations to try to get the information out on, you know, when the placarding effort is going to start, when the collections are going to start. And then as we get further into the response, We'll be, you know, coordinating more directly with cities and other groups when we start talking about first pass, second pass. Typically, we'll have all of that information up on the website so that you can see that as well. So just like all of you, we have detailed storm response planning that we go through, pre-storm. And all of that for us really culminates when we hit tropical storm force winds. That's when we are required 40 mile per hour to take our trucks off the road. The operations at the transfer stations will cease, operations at the landfill will cease. And at that point, we're buckled up and we're ready to go. Post-storm, as we mentioned, first order of business is, damage assessment and getting everything ready to go to respond. And then, again, depending on the severity of the storm, we have had the sites up and running within 48 hours. It may not always be that quickly, but that has been the case in the last couple of responses. So these are the list of the 2022 pre-authorized sites. These are the publicly owned sites. I think all of you that have been doing this for a while should be familiar. This is not a new list. Dyer Landfill, which is across the turnpike, our site here, Okeechobee, Okeheli, Park South, Palm Beach Downs, South County Regional Park. And let me just shout out to the Parks Department. These guys are just great to work with, and they always help us out with providing sites for us, especially the South County Regional Park, which is our biggest area down south. Pike Road and the Turnpike, Belglade Transfer Station, the Central County Transfer Station on Lantana, Southwest County Transfer Station, which is 441 out in the Southwest Del Rey, and then the biosolids processing facility, which is down at the end of the road. Now, not all of these sites are going to be activated for every storm, okay? It will depend largely on the magnitude of the storm, and these sites will also be augmented by the sites that private collectors, Ashbridge and the others, can provide. So it's going to depend on a storm-by-storm basis which sites are open, how many are open, and again, based on the magnitude of the storm. We have learned lessons in the past. We know, for example, during Irma, when the entire site was clamoring for the entire state was clamoring for resources, we had more sites open than most. We had less waiting time, and those collectors were more willing to stay and service our areas because they could get in and out quickly. And you know, for them, that's what it's all about. They want to get that turnaround. So we do realize that, and we will open as many as we think we need. To try to get everybody in and out in an efficient manner. So again, we talked a little bit about the municipal sites. I know there's a couple municipalities out there that have in the past operated their own sites. And all we ask is that you provide us with the information on those sites and give us some contact information. If you're contemplating that, Karen with our environmental group, she can help you with that. Those all need to be pre-authorized by DEP, and that is a process. Tickets, electronic tickets. You'll notice that I didn't put paper on here, okay? I know that there are a few of you that indicated that you still want to use paper. All I can do is strongly, and I think I'll say it one more time, strongly recommend that you go to electronic tickets if you aren't already going down that road. It makes things so much easier in terms of collecting the information, but more importantly, reconciling the information and getting you the feedback that you need, getting us the feedback, getting you the feedback that you need in a more efficient way on a daily, weekly, monthly basis. So if you're using paper, it just makes that process a lot more difficult and a lot more error prone, in my opinion. This is just an example of the tickets that we've used in the past. The Thompson ADMS system, I know you can't read the information really on there, but it's just, it's all the basic information, the site, the time, the coordinates, the load, et cetera, et cetera. I'm sure you're all very familiar with those. This is just a list of municipal codes. Again, I know you guys should all be familiar with this. Nothing new there. But these are key to get right on the ticket system so that everybody gets charged appropriately. As far as the loading and the debris site monitoring, we don't really plan any major changes. We have Thompson working with us as our consultant, and then all of the collectors, Ashbritt, Crowder, Phillips, and CS, all are veterans, all have worked with us for many years. And we did have a few glitches with GPS during the last storm, but we've got those worked out, and I really don't anticipate any issues at all with the site monitoring operations. This is just a slide provided by Thompson, just kind of goes over their ADMS system, their load ticket system. I don't think there's anything new here. They back up everything with photos, and again, makes all of the reconciliation very, very much easier post-storm. So we said we would touch a little bit on gated communities. This is an issue that comes up every single year, and it's one that I think we've gotten a lot better at in terms of response. As you all know, generally speaking, FEMA will not reimburse for collection within private gated communities. Two very important things that need to be established if you're going to have any hope of getting reimbursement from FEMA. And one is the determination of need, the public determination of need. And the second is the indemnification of FEMA. And so we've accomplished that in a couple of ways. The Palm Beach County Post-Disaster Debris Recovery Ordinance and the Mandatory Collection Resolution, those two things have been modified over the years to give us the authority and the ability to collect within those private gated communities in the unincorporated areas, and also establish the determination need and also establish the FEMA indemnification. This is just a little bit more information on those two ordinances, and those can be found again on the website if you want to look at those in a little more detail. As we've done in the past, we also, as a backup, to establish the need, we get the written letters from the health department, the county, the health department county, and I think the sheriff's is the other one that we typically get on that. And you may want to get that. So this is just the contact information for myself. John will be retiring at the end of June. So if you need anything from John, we'll have to get him quick. He's going to miss the bulk of the season. But he's been doing this a long time, and he's a wealth of knowledge. Mariana and Paul, both, again, very knowledgeable and veterans of many storms. Willie, who is manning the computer over there, he also serves as our person at the EOC during and after a storm. Don White is our risk management director. He's relatively new. And then, again, Karen Cantor, who's with our environmental program, and she can assist you if you have information, if you need information for pre-authorization of sites. And I think with that, we're going to go to questions. Yep. Sure. She's from Haverhill, and she was saying that she thought that paper was the only option. And as I'm sure you've garnered, paper is the least preferred option. I think just contact one of us after, and we can. I don't know if you use a consultant at Lantana, if you use Thompson, or if you use somebody else. But we can point you in the right direction. There are lots of systems out there, And I believe that Thompson can work with other systems, not just their system. They can take some of these other systems and meld them and work with them. So we can provide you with information on that, yeah. I saw a hand back here somewhere. No? Yeah. Yes, as of actually this morning. We got the last one done this morning. That procurement process was concluded in April, and so they are all back, they're all signed, they're all online, and they're ready for you to piggyback should you so desire to do that. Yeah. Anybody else? How about online, Willie? Yeah, Diego, who's joining us virtually, if you could express your question in the chat, we would appreciate it. Anybody else in the room?
All right, this question is from Diego with Parks and Recreation. After the hurricane season, Ocoheele Park South will be developed with a proposed campground. We do not have a smaller cleared area south of water utilities, but vegetation is encroaching and it is not what it once was when the site was first added to the SWA plan. If the SWA is willing to help clear some encroaching exotic vegetation, it would help with the space available. The space will be available for approximately 3 more years with future plans being developed. Please plan an alternative site location as early as next year if space requirements are not met. This communication was sent to Armin Gregorian with Public Safety and Jennifer Cirillo with Parks and Rec.
Well, we'll coordinate that with the Parks Department. You know, again, Ocoheele is not one that I think we've used on a regular basis, and so we'll coordinate that clearing with the Parks Department and take it off the list if it's no longer available. But as of now, it could be available for use if we need it in some way, shape, or form. Okay, if there are no further questions, we're gonna adjourn. Thank you all for coming, and let's hope for the best this season.